page 346.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Well, it's good to see you this morning. I'm glad it's you, Sunday. It makes me feel right at home up here. Come on. Yeah, come on now. But it's good to be here. Good to see you in the Lord's house. It's a little different service today. You can say we don't go back to program a whole lot. We're going to try something a little different. The youth got a little slideshow they're going to present here in a little bit. And if it all works out for the... That technology doesn't work back there. We got that simple technology. We can pray to the Lord. It never lets us down. We don't have to worry about high tech when it comes to reaching the Lord. But it's good to see you this morning. Good to be in the Lord's house. Good to have Brother David David Durham, his son Matthew, is going to be breaking bread of life. Uplift him, pray for him. God, just touch him, use him, anoint him. And for his heart that needs a touch this morning, maybe this will be the hour that the Lord will show up, Holy Spirit will do his work, and lives will be changed. A few announcements, we'll go, Father. Do remember, today is Youth Sunday. Pray for these young people this morning. They'll be coming and singing here in a little bit. Thursday night, 6:30, Brotherhood out here in the Fellowship Hall. Be there for that. You got the information here for the art trip. Just get with Miss Sherry and let her know about that. Remember these folks traveling. Got a lot of folks traveling. Got a lot of folks out sick. A lot of prayer needs. A lot of sickness. The death angel's been busy this week. So remember these folks that lost loved ones. Let me read the card right quick and we'll move forward. It says, thanks for all the prayers. The family of Bonnard Baker, thanks you for your kind expression of sympathy. The Baker family. Do remember this family in the past, the Baker family in that past, others there that have gone on, the Ritchie family and others. God's still on the throne. Doesn't take him by surprise. It's all on his timetable. But it's all going according to his plan. But again, it's good to have you this morning. Good to have you at Mount Carmel. Good to see all our visitors, your special guests. Make yourself at home and just mind the Lord. Anything else need to be added before we go any further? If not, we'll ask our ushers to come forward and we'll take this morning's offering.
This slideshow actually brings you all the way back from the Harvest Festival that we had back in October. And it just gives you little tidbits of what we've been doing with the youth. Can't capture everything, but, you know, from the play practice that we had in December, and Roger's already spoke a little bit before about that, but it's really amazing that the kids that we have in this church and what they're willing to give back to the Lord. And we've mentioned it before, you know, to have a teenager that's willing to get in the car, make the decision to drive down here to the house of God when they could go across town and hang out with friends, but yet they were willing to come and serve the Lord. So they're really, it's just a great group. We don't have a huge group here, but I'm just so thankful for what we do have. But this will get you all the way back to October. And so y'all just be patient. It's about 20 minutes, and we hope that the music comes through. We had some issues with that, but if the music doesn't come through, then you'll at least have the pictures. But it's about 19 minutes, I think, and then hopefully after the art trip, we'll try to get you some pictures from that.
Tell the old story of his love. just wanna thank. I just wanna thank you for always being there when I was so down. Wanna shout, I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If I had a thousand lives to live, I'd give them all to my Lord, for he's been so good to me. That is the least I could afford. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just wanna thank you, Lord, for every time you heard me pray. I just wanna thank you for always being there when I was so down and out. You came along and made me wanna shout. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When I was so down and out, you came along and made me wanna shout. I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, I just wanna thank you, Lord. Thank you,
touched by man, prepared for the saved and fled. A city built for his many have tried, but they couldn't describe all the beauties on that bright shore. For it's never entered into the hearts of men what the Father has in store. I could sing about heaven for a million years and never get the story told. Of the jasper walls and the gates of pearl and the streets made of pure gold. Even John the Revelator in a heavenly vision could never really say what he saw. And I could sing about heaven for a million years and still I could never tell it all. Yeah, from the throne there springs a glimmering stream with waters pure and sweet. And it flows by the tree of life on its way to the crystal sea. And the precious stones that the walls rest on are all 12 different kinds. And there the night will cease, for the Prince of Peace is the light that forever shines. And I can sing about heaven for a million years and there. Story told on the jasper walls and the gates of pearl and the streets made of pure gold. Even John the Revelator in a heavenly vision could never really say what he saw. And I could sing about heaven for a million years and still I could never tell it all. Even John the Revelator in a heavenly vision could never really say what he saw. And I could sing about heaven for a million years and still I could never tell it all.
There's folks building walls as sweet as can be. They live in the oars, they're planting their trees. But my little love, I just let it be. For my Jesus is dead. Pass away. getting ready to move with me on that day. I said, mansions for me. My Lord, beyond Calvary, but my little hood, I just let it be. All my Jesus did build a mansion for me. All my Jesus did build.
Kind of gives you a detail about the youth. That's tomorrow's church. And how much quality time you spend with your church or your youth depends on what quality of church you'll have tomorrow. Again, I'd like to thank everyone that spent time with these youth, some of these projects we've gone on and gone before. As you can see, we don't have a set routine here, but I'm just glad to say, I just want to thank the Lord that you still feel his presence. Whether it be just knowing, if we can take time out and shut the world out for just a moment and focus on him. We talked to the boys a little bit about Isaiah chapter 6 and the year that King Uzziah, Isaiah said, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. We got to stop and see the Lord. He said, go. How long until the cities be desolate? We got a work to do until the Lord returns. We got to be his servants. Amazing grace. I'm glad we live under grace. I think last week's message was on grace. I'm thankful that we have a gracious God, that he's still in the saving business. He saves old sinners like me. Brother Matthew, come ahead.
Good morning. It's good to be back with you this week. I appreciate the privilege to stand in Mount Carmel's pulpit and break open the bread of life this morning. If you have your Bibles, you would, turn with me to Mark chapter 4. As we turn, has anyone got a word this morning? Mark chapter 4. I'll begin reading in verse 35. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. If you're there and you're willing and able, would you stand for the reading of God's word? And the same day, when the evening was come, he said unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. When they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said unto him, Master, cares thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And when they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and sea obey him? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God, I come to you this morning, Lord, and I ask your blessings on your red word this morning, Father. Lord, I ask you, God, to hide me behind the shadow of the cross this morning. God, you know my heart. Lord, you know what I stand in need of this morning, God. And Lord, I pray for an anointment. God, I pray for unction to be able to preach this morning. God, preach with power. Lord, I pray, God, if there's one that's cold and indifferent from you, Father, that you'll reclaim them. One that's lost, Father God, you'll present, Lord, your saving grace to them this morning, Father. And most of all, everything that's done here this morning, let it be for your honor and for your glory. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I have just a simple question for you this morning. I shared with you last week that over the last several months, God's begun to reveal and begin to deal with me on various topics. And last week we looked at grace, and we were, I believe it was a Sunday night service back last year. My wife and I were at our home church in Henniger, and we sang a song that we've sang, I've probably sang it 1,000 times sitting in a pew. It is well with my soul. And I stopped, and I heard the words for the first time. It says, whatever my lot, you've taught me to say. Whatever my lot. And I ask myself, and I ask you this morning, the question I want you to dwell on this morning, the thought that I have is it? Is it well with your soul this morning? Is it? Can you honestly say that whatever life deals you, whatever your lot is in life, that you can step back and you can say, but it is well with my soul. You have taught me to say, it is well with my soul. You see, we see men here, we're fixing to get into in Mark chapter 4, we see the disciples, and they give us a good picture, a good example of what a storm of life looks like, of what me and you may go through, what we may walk through in this life, and we see a couple things that I feel we need to glean from Scripture this morning and apply to ourselves. Now, these disciples were experienced fishermen. They had been on the Sea of Galilee many, many times. This was not the first storm that they had ever been in, I'm sure. The way the landscape lays there, Mount Hermon, I believe it is, the cold air that comes off the top of the mountain would meet the warm air right over the sea and would cause these kind of storms, would cause a thunderstorm. But when you look at this word, a storm of wind, it's actually translated, it literally means a whirlwind, what you and I would call a hurricane. Now, these are experienced fishermen who have been out in a boat before, been through rain, been through wind, but yet they found themselves in the middle of somewhere they didn't know if they were going to make it to the other side. And they were terrified. A lot of times, as I'm getting older, I'm beginning to see different storms in my life. When I was living at home, I didn't know what a financial storm looked like. I didn't have financials. I had mom and dad take care of me. I'm recently married. Last 3 years, I figured out you got to put a little work into a marriage to make it work. Sometimes storms can come up in your spouse's life, in your life, the different things that you've not ever realized before. And I'm beginning to understand that when I was 18 years old and I thought, I've got this figured out. I've got life figured out. I can conquer the world. I soon found myself out in the middle of a storm. And I didn't know if I was going to make it to the other side. This morning, you may be in the storm of your life. You may not know if you're going to make it to the other side. You can't see the horizon for the rain and for the wind and for the waves. This morning, I want to give you some comfort. I want to give you a couple things out of Scripture that Mark lays out that I think that we can take to heart and to say there's reasons not to be disturbed this morning. There's four of them specifically. First, we see the promise. Verse 35. It says, "In the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side." Christ had already told them where they were going. Christ had already commanded them, said to them, hey, let's go to the other side. Folks, this morning, if you're in the storm of your life and God sent you in that direction, you see, a lot of times when a storm comes in my life, I automatically go back and I think, what have I done wrong? What have I done to deserve this? How have I messed up? What sin is in my life that has caused this? But the disciples did no wrong. This was a storm of obedience, not disobedience. This wasn't like Jonah who said, I'm not going to go, and he gets swallowed up by a great fish. This was the disciples saying, yes, Lord, I'll go. When God's called you to something, when God's laid something on your heart, when God has told you you need to make a move in your job, you need to begin to talk to this person at work, you need to step into this kind of ministry, you need to do whatever it may be, and a storm comes up, take heart that the promise has been given, that He's promised you, I've called you to this, I'm going to get you to the other side. When I was 8 years old, I got my first promise. I was in a little Baptist church on Sylvania Gap. I walked down to an old-fashioned altar and I said, Lord, I don't have a clue how you're going to do this. I'm not deserving. I don't understand it all, but I know I'm lost. And I gave my heart and life to Him, and He sealed me from that point. And He said, no matter how rough the waves may get, I promise you, we'll get to the other side. Whatever storms of life come up, we've been given the promise. We've been given the assurance that He's going to take us through, that He's on the boat with us, that we're not looking for Him on the horizon, but yet He's riding with me. But you see, the disciples here were given a great opportunity. They had just heard for the past solid day. This was the same day as the day the parables were given. And he said, and by evening time, he said, let us go to the other side. Now they're given a great opportunity, an opportunity to apply what they've just heard. And we see how they so quickly forget, as we'll get to in a few minutes. But there was an opportunity for application. You see, when you hear different sermons, when you hear different teachings, when you read, when God reveals to you, and when you begin to learn and to dig deeper into Scripture, that's just more opportunities for application. Preaching is not finished until we go out and apply it. There's opportunities for application. There's opportunities to say, yes, Lord, I'll go. I'll be like Isaiah, here I am, Lord, send me. No matter what comes up, I hold to the promise that you're going to carry me across. Isaiah chapter 14, let me just read it. Isaiah 14, verse 27, For the Lord of hosts has purposed, and who shall disannul it? And His hand is stretched out, and who shall turn it back? Nothing in this life, nothing that comes up in your life can hinder the work of God. Christ never promised us an easy trip. Christ never said that it's going to be smooth sailing. Christ never said, He actually says, you're not worthy unless you separate yourselves from your families, from your mother, your father, your sisters, your children, and take up your cross, your instrument of death, and you bear that with me and follow me. He never promised an easy trip, but what He did promise was the destination. The old saying, if God brought you to it, He'll bring you through it. That's absolutely scripturally true. Albeit it may not be an easy ride, it may not be a smooth sail, but it's a promised destination this morning. Secondly, verse 36, we see the presence. When they'd sent away the multitude, they took Him even as He was in the ship, and there were also with Him other little ships. Not only did Christ give them the promise, but he literally stepped on board. He was already on board the boat. He could have just very easily, we know from Scripture, he could have just walked across the water and been waiting on them on the other side. He could have got out and walked around on land and been waiting for them if they made it. But no, my Jesus says, you go to the other side and I'm going to come along with you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to go with you. I'm going to bear it with you. I was in, I'm a physical therapist assistant by trade, and I work in a nursing home, and I was in a patient's room the other day, and I saw on their wall they had hung up the poem, I believe it's called Footprints. And I love that last part. When the man that the poem's talking about, he says, but Lord, at times there's only one set of footprints. He said, that's because you weren't strong enough to stand and I carried you. Sometimes in life, sometimes the storms come up and we don't even have the strength to stand, but we have the presence of our Savior, our God, the one who spun this world into order and spoke it into being, the one who created me and you and gave us the breath of life to say, I'll carry you. I'll go with you. And when you read this, when I read this, and when I look at the disciples, I look at them and I say, how could they ever think that they weren't going to make it? How could they ever think that Christ was with them and they weren't going to make it? Haven't they just seen him turn water into wine and heal and raise from the dead? All these things that he's done, how could they be so afraid with all the miracles that they've seen? And I think back in my own life, and I get in storms in my life, and I go back to thinking of all the miracles in my life. And I think that little Baptist church on Sylvania Gap, and I think that miracle that he was able to take someone like me, someone so wretched, so vile, so undeserving, and somehow make me righteous enough to come to his presence and someday spend eternity with him. And yet I stand in the back, just like the disciples, crying out, where are you? Where are you? I have this theory of my own life that I fall guilty a lot of times of putting God in a box. I have this idea of what God is able to do. And it's a nice, neat little box, and I put him in it, and I say, when something hits my life, I say, all right, Lord, you can handle that. That's inside the box. But when something goes terribly wrong in my life, I lose a loved one, when my job doesn't work out, when I sit at home for months and can't figure out how to pay the bills, when things come up in my life and I think that's outside the box, that's outside of what my God can do. I've got him in this nice, neat little box. He's not able to do that. Then I have to fall flat on my face in repentance and say, but Lord, you don't belong in a box. My God isn't set by... He's not limited by what I can imagine. He's not limited by what I can think and how I can try to perceive him. He's beyond my imagination. He's beyond my thinking. He's beyond anything in this world. He is God. And he goes with us. So we're given the promise. We're given his presence. Thirdly, verse 38, he was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. We're given peace. Peace. We see here, now imagine with me, this is not the VeggieTales version. That's the vision I had for so long held in my mind of this particular Bible story, of Jesus calming the sea and the wind and the waves. Is the VeggieTales version, where it's a sailboat and it's kind of rocking back and forth and Jesus is asleep on a pillow, and he wakes up and he says, peace, and everything's fine. This is not at all how it began. This is not just some regular thunderstorm. This is not just some little rain shower. This is not just a rough day on the water. This is what you and I would call a hurricane. This is not a sailboat. This is not a big cruise ship. This is actually a rowboat. They literally had oars and were rowing across the sea. So now I want you to get the picture. I want you to see the disciples sitting there and fighting for their life. The wind and the waves beating against the boat, probably tearing it apart. And they're trying to hold on to their oar and trying to row and keep the boat going in one general direction. They're trying to keep it afloat. It's already filling up with water. They're doing everything they can. They're probably shouting across the aisle to one another because they can't hear because of the sound of the storm and the lightning and the thunder and just how terrible and how terrifying it must have been. And then we see Christ asleep in perfect peace. A lot of times, I'm that disciple. I'm in my boat, and I'm fighting with everything that I have. I'm trying to conquer this storm as best that I can. I'm trying to figure it out on my own. I'm trying to row. I'm trying to fight. And there's absolutely no peace whatsoever. And my response is the disciples' response. The flesh's response is, does he even care? Does Christ even care this morning? We sing a song. It's in one of our song books at Henniger, and it says, does Jesus care? And when you first sing that, when you hear that, my first response is, well, of course he cares. But how many times in my life have I been fighting? How many times have we been in the middle of the storm trying to figure it out on our own? Trying to let Matthew figure it out. Trying to let the flesh lead and guide. And we're just trying to fight as much as we can to keep the boat up, to keep our lives moving. We just don't think we're going to make it. And we scream out with all that we have, Lord, do you even care? And all the while, he's peacefully asleep. Right there with us. You see, that's two pictures of the response there. The disciples that are fighting for everything they have, that's how Matthew wants to figure it out. When Matthew's just trying to do it through himself, do it through the flesh. The picture of Christ asleep in the boat is when I just turn it over to him. And I say, Lord, I can't control this, but I know you can. I know you've promised me a destination. I know you're here with me, and I know you can give me peace. And lastly, we've seen his promise, we've seen his presence, we've seen his peace. Lastly, we see his power in verse 39. And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Now this is something that I can't even imagine. This is something that I can't even figure out. Kendall and I, she graduated college in December. We went to Charleston, South Carolina, and got on a cruise ship at Christmas, and we headed somewhere warm. Now, it was nice when we got there, and we've been on cruises before. It's usually smooth sailing. I don't know if it was just the time of year or what, but we got back, and everybody asked us how it was. I said, it was fine. We were sitting still. I said, when we were moving, I said, even this great big old ship, and the waves weren't big. They weren't rough. It rained maybe 5 minutes the whole trip, and the wind blew just a little. But I was standing in our room trying to get ready, and I was rocking back and forth, trying to put a jacket on or button a shirt. And how rough that was for that great big old ship. Now, I just can't imagine someone walking out on the stern of that ship and saying, peace, and it being like glass. But folks, I'm telling you, it's God's Word is error-proof. It's perfect. There's nothing wrong with it. I can promise you, it's in here. He's done it, and he's done it in my life. But there's something to notice about this story that I had missed my entire childhood. Verse 37. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship. Notice the end of the verse. So that it was now full. The wind and sea obeyed. It became a perfect day to sail once Christ woke up. The storm was over. The fear was gone. But not before the boat was full. There was still evidence of a storm. They were wet. They were probably sitting in water. And while they knew their destination was promised, when they realized that this man, they stood in awe of him as we're fixing to see, when they realized his power that he had over the wind and over the waves, but they were still wet. In storms of life, when you get to the other side, there's still going to be evidence that you've come through a storm sometimes. It's not always going to be smooth sailing, but I promise you, we'll get to the other side. Horatio Spafford was a businessman in the mid to late 1800s. He owned a business in Chicago, had four little girls and a wife. Within a year, he lost his business in Chicago to the Great Chicago Fire. Shortly after that, he built it back, was prospering again, seemed like everything was okay. And his daughters and his wife get on a cruise liner to head towards Europe. About halfway through the trip, they strike a Scottish ship, and within 12 minutes, the ship's gone. He waits a week, and he finally gets a telegram from his wife, and it says, "Saved alone, what do I do?" He had lost his children in this horrific accident. Naturally, he closes up his business and gets on the next cruise liner to go over to Europe to meet his wife. And they're about halfway there, and the captain calls him to his room. And he says, "We're over the spot where you lost your four daughters." He said he walked back to his room, and he pinned down, "It is well with my soul. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot you have taught me to say, it is well." My question to you this morning is, can you say that it is? Are you in a storm in your life right now to where you just don't know if you're going to make it? You just don't know that you've got the strength to go on. You feel like God's 1,000 miles away and He's not hearing you. You feel like there's no hope for tomorrow. You just need the peace that only God can give. I don't know your hearts this morning, but I'll tell you, I've been burdened this entire week to pray for this church this morning, more than I normally do. I don't know your hearts, and I keep telling the Lord that, "Lord, I don't know. I don't know your hearts this morning." But if you stand in need, if you're in the middle of a storm, if you stand in need for something that only God can give, the peace that He can give, the presence of Him, just the anointment to know that He's there this morning, this altar is open as they come to the instruments, as we stand. I don't know your hearts this morning, but I know the heart reader. And I know the one that can give me peace. I know the one that goes with me. I know the one that's, if He's called me, He's promised me I'm going to make it. And if I don't, I'll meet Him in glory. If you stand in need of something this morning, this altar is open. So we sing 299.